What did we learn in the previous session? Remember anything? What did we learn?
Overwriting, overloading.
Exactly. We learned about the polymorphism concept of object-oriented programming. So polymorphism can be achieved by using method overloading concept or method overriding concept. Method overloading is compile time polymorphism, whereas method overriding is a runtime polymorphism. For method overloading, a single class is enough. For method overriding, we need minimum two classes. And the method overloading does not inherit anything, but for method overloading, method overriding, we should inherit a class, then only we can override the existing method of the parent class. So in overloading, in the same class, you can write the same method with a different parameter so that the method will be overloaded. In overriding, you need a class parent where there is a method, and you need a child class which overrides the same method. And overloading does not consider the return type of the method, whereas overriding considers the return type as well. If the return type is changed, then that does not override. So those were the things that we learned in our previous session, right? Overloading and overriding. And then why do we need this overriding also, we have seen. How do we do and why do we do? Right? Okay. So now let's see the other concept of object-oriented programming called abstraction. Okay. Abstraction. Class. So abstraction is another concept of object-oriented programming, where abstraction means you are deriving something from other, right? Abstraction. So what does abstraction mean? Quality of dealing with the process of removing physical, spatial, or temporal details or attributes in the study of. Have any other way, freedom from representational quality, not good. So we are abstraction means here we are having raw value where we are fetch, we are going to implement those things in Java. Let me try this. See, data abstraction is the process of hiding certain details and showing only essential information to the user. This can be achieved by the help of classes. So what are we doing here is we are abstracting something from the other class. So what is the other class? What will it have? And how do we implement this abstraction? Okay. So we use the keyword called abstract to create abstract classes. Abstract class. Suppose I'll say vehicle. Where do we use these abstract classes? Is you know the rules. There will be a business analyst, there will be a developer, there will be a tester, there will be a product owner. So these kind of rules will be there. Now, the developer or tester cannot go and sit with the customer to get the requirements, right? Developer and the tester will not. There will be a person called business analyst or the product owner. If it is an agile project, we call him as product owner. So he'll coordinate with the customers, he'll discuss with the end customer, client. He will discuss with the client and he will get all the requirements. While getting the requirements, there will be some mandatory requirements that the developer has to fix or that the developer has to develop. So those kind of methods, while discussing with the business analyst or while discussing with the client, they cannot implement the methods right away. So what the business analyst or product owner does is they create an abstract class and then they mention all the methods that has to be mandatorily present in the application. All the functionality that has to be mandatorily present in the application. So So that methods or that list will be present inside this abstract class. So these abstract classes works as index. You know, whenever we have some textbooks or whenever we have some projects, the beginning we'll have some preface and about, and then we have index. So in the index, what does the index show? What are all the chapters present inside it? What are the topics inside the chapters and the page numbers associated with it? That's all. But there will be no information about the chapter and chapter content, right? They'll just mention chapter name, what do you say, subject or content or topic, subtopic, and then their page numbers. That's all. Then whatever is present in index, that should be mandatorily present inside the textbook, right? If something which is mentioned in the index is not present inside the book, will you buy it? Index says it should be having 500 pages, but the book is having only 100 pages. Will you accept it? All right. Because we'll assume that by seeing the index, we'll assume that, okay, some of the requirements are missing or some of the pages are missing, and you will take another book which is having 500 pages from the same copy. In a similar way, these abstract classes are used as indexes or references for the developers where they have to develop all the methods. Okay, so now for example, let us assume that shopping site or e-commerce site. In anything, we can take an e-commerce site. Now, while discussing with the team, with the business analyst or the client, they have given some requirements. What are their requirements? They need login functionality. So, what login? And then they told this login can also be done with a third party login like Wired login via Gmail or like void login via Gmail. And then they also need, sorry, here I should not write the implementation. This is an abstract class, right? So I won't write anything. I'll just and these are abstract methods, so I have to mention abstract. Now see, this is gone. So what am I doing here is I'm creating abstract methods with no body. Earlier, when we wrote methods, here, when we write methods, we write this, and then we also have the implementation part inside the methods. But for abstraction, we do not have the implementation part. We just declare the names of the methods that we are going to implement. And then, after that, what do we want? We want void product search. There should be a functionality or there should be a feature for the product search. And then similarly, I want wish list. Similarly, I want cart. Similarly, I want payment methods COD. Then I want payment. Then I want payment method as cards. Like this. So whatever the features they want, they'll mention like this inside the abstract class. Okay. So when do we call some classes abstract class? Whenever there is at least one abstract method inside the class. At least one abstract method. This is an abstract method. This is an abstract method. All these are abstract methods. So when a class contains at least one abstract method inside it, then the class must be abstract. You see, if I remove the abstract, it is throwing an error. What is error? You see, e-commerce site abstract. A type to abstract. The type e-commerce site must be an abstract class to define abstract. If you want to define abstract methods inside a class, or if you are having abstract methods inside a class, then this class should be abstract. Okay. Now see, if there are abstract methods, it is mandatory that the class should be abstract. Okay, I'm doing this. Now you see, I'll remove these methods. But is it throwing an error? When there are no abstract methods also, it doesn't throw any error. You can create classes without abstract methods. But the class should become abstract when there is at least one abstract method inside it. Otherwise, there is no use of keeping these classes abstract. If you do not have any abstract methods inside the class and then you mark this as an abstract class, that is of useless because there is no abstract methods inside it. Okay. Now we got all the requirements of this e-commerce site. All the requirements or all the index methods or all the declarations of methods were already given by business analyst or product owner to us. Now we have to implement these methods. And the developer has to start working on it. So there will be guidelines that every developer who is working has to implement these abstract class, because this is the place or this is the class we are implementing, or these are the methods that we have to implement. In order to make sure that we don't miss any of these methods, what we do is, see, there's class. I'll say I'm creating a Flipkart class, but Flipkart is an e-commerce site, for example, right? This is an e-commerce site. It has to implement all these methods. So what I'm going to do is, this is abstract class. So I'm going to say extends. Now it should be implements. Implements e-commerce site. Because I'm going to implement all the methods of this e-commerce. Yeah, you see, class to class, it should be extends. Interface to class, it should be implements. So this is a class, and here also I'm implementing a class. I'm going to write the methods of this class. So I'm using the keyword called extends. Like I'm creating a parent and child relationship between both of them. For this, if you are extending an abstract class, you have to implement all these methods inside that class. If you don't implement all these methods, it will throw an error. You see here, what is the error? The type Flipkart must implement the inherited abstract method login. Once I implement this login, it will show error for login by Gmail. Then once I implement, it will show error for this. So you see the suggestion? Add unimplemented methods. If I click this add unimplemented methods, you see all the methods with the code will be implemented here. That's all. So that we don't miss any of the requirements, and so that we don't miss, or we will implement all the required methods. And we don't have to give the information about our classes where we are implementing the exact code to anybody who is using. We can give the class as this e-commerce site, and anybody can call the method from this e-commerce site so that this will call this method, because this is overriding, right? So this overridden method will be called. Understood? So this is about abstract classes. Now you see here, I can write any implementation. But you know, okay. And then now there won't be any single developer inside the organization. So for this project, there might be multiple developers working on all of these functionality. So I am working on these things, login, login via Gmail and Flutter. So it's my responsibility to develop templates for these things. I already wrote this implementation, for example. Okay, this is my implementation. But these methods, I am not going to work on it. So I don't have to implement here. I don't want to implement it here. So I remove them. But this class will throw an error because there are some methods which are not implemented from the abstract. So in that case, if you are implementing these methods in multiple classes or in different places, then what you have to do is you have to make this class also abstract. Now it doesn't throw any error. Okay. Further, when you create another class, okay, class Flipkart 2, for example, Flipkart 2, then see here. Flipkart is already extending e-commerce site and I implemented only partial methods of this. There are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 methods, but I implemented only 3. There are remaining 4 methods, right? So what I'm going to do is I will extend this Flipkart class so that it will say what are the unimplemented methods. You see, I will get only 4 unimplemented methods, which I did not implement inside this class. See? Right? So you can either implement all the unimplemented methods inside a single class, or if you don't wish to implement all the methods inside a single class, you can extend that class into another class, but we should make sure that partial implemented class should be also called as abstract class. Understood? Okay, here I can have that's all. Okay. Now, if we create object for this e-commerce site, site object is equals to new e-commerce. Is it allowing us to create an object? Is it allowing us to create an object for e-commerce? Yeah. Is it allowing us to create an object for e-commerce site? It won't allow, or we cannot create objects for abstract classes. We cannot create objects for abstract classes. But you see here, we are overriding the methods of these abstract classes. If you remember our previous session, when you are having overriding concept, what did we do? We created an object for parent class. Sorry, we created an object for child class and we are converting it to parent type, right? C5 method overriding. C5 method overriding riding is a child class of sample class. Okay. So I created an object for C5 method overriding and then converted it to what? Sample parent object. Now let us do the same thing here. So here, e-commerce site is the parent, and who is the child? Flipkart is the child. Okay, right. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to create, or I'm going to call the constructor of this Flipkart class. But still, there are few unimplemented methods of Flipkart class from the abstract class. So these are the 4. So what? How? What do we know with from this? That means this is partially implemented class. There is another class which is implemented fully. So what I'm going to do is I'll make it as Flipkart 2 so that I can remove all these things. This is small, so that is why it is. Okay. Now you see. So this is the class. Or this is the place where all the other methods implementation is completed. There are no pending abstract methods, or there are no pending classes that there are no pending methods that we should implement here. Okay. So now, if you see here, for which class I created object? Flipkart2, which is this, right? Now, how many methods I have? 1, 2, 3, 4 only. But you see, login via Gmail and product search are not present in Flipkart2. But since we are converting this child object to parent object, now see that. You will also see the login method.
So you are giving override here?
No, that even if you don't mention this override, it will be overriding. By default, that will come as override because we are overriding it. It is not mandatory to mention this annotation. It is not mandatory. This abstraction is nothing but overriding the already declared methods. Here we have declared the login method, but we do not have any implementation. Now we want to add implementation. So what we are doing? We are creating a child class and overriding this abstract method, which does not have any implementation. I added some implementation, like I added some C source statement. Understood?
So the minute you extended to the child class, it's automatically giving you the override.
It won't override. Let me show you. For example, yes. Now it doesn't. Okay. This, there is another class here, right? So I'll just remove this. Now you can see this. Now you see, when you write a class extends, it will come like this. Now there is an error. You see here, Flipkart2 has an error. What is that error? Must implement the inherited abstract method e-commerce site dot payment methods cash on delivery, because this method is not implemented in the previous class, is it? No, so that is why it is throwing. It is showing one method, but it is also suggesting some. It is also suggesting some thing that add unimplemented methods. We should implement all the unimplemented methods. If I click on it, it is giving me all the messages. With this, automatically it will create the syntax for it. Then we can start writing our own method. That is what I did. That is how I did.
Okay, can you go a little bit up, please? So the Flipkart is abstract. Can you go a little bit up, please? So the e-commerce site is abstract class.
Yes, this is abstract class because we have all, we have minimum of one abstract method. Since we have an abstract method inside the class, we should mention this class as abstract class.
So this acts as a parent now.
Yes, it doesn't act as a parent. This is just an abstract class. But when you are overriding the methods, you are extending the e-commerce side. So then when you are doing this, when you are implementing these methods, this e-commerce side will become parent. But when you have only abstract class, it is not a parent, it is not a child, it is just an abstract class. But when you are trying to implement it, then we create this as parent, or we use this as parent class.
So the Flipkart got the property from e-commerce set, right?
Exactly. It got all e-commerce, the properties.
Yeah, but we don't have anything in the abstract class. That's where I'm confused. Usually parents will have some.
No, see, we don't have anything inside this. The meaning of abstract is that you don't have any implementation. We just have the index. That is why I told, right? In the book, in the beginning, I gave an explanation, theoretical explanation. In a book, in the index page, do you have any topic explanations? Or you have just the topic title and the page numbers?
Okay, so
this is kind of index. You'll just have the declarations of the methods. The implementations of this will be in the extended classes or implementation classes. This abstract class should be implemented mandatorily.
So where do we use this? Oh, it doesn't have anything inside. So how do we use this?
This is how we are using. It doesn't have anything inside it. So what are we doing? We are implementing these abstract classes. See, assume this as an index page. You have all the titles of the topics that you are going to read inside the book. Okay? Now you are at a bookstore and you saw this index. This index says that these are the 7 chapters that you are going to read in this book, and this is about 500 pages. But when you open the book and see, there are only 100 pages. Will you accept that book, or will you exchange it with a new one, which is having all the pages? Obviously, we are going to check that, and then we are going to accept which is having all these chapters and which is having all the pages, right? So if they mention in the index and they don't implement in the book, or they don't write, or they don't add those pages in the book, we are rejecting it. In the same way, this is an abstract class where all the requirements are declared. These are all the mandatory requirements that the client needs. So now we have to implement all these things. How are we making sure that we are implementing all these things? By making them abstract. And then we are asking our developers to extend these abstract classes so that they have to implement all the unimplemented methods. Okay. Now, so to make sure that I have to implement all these methods, or to write the code for these methods, I extended this e-commerce set so that I will know what are the methods I have to work on. And I don't have this, for example, Flipkart 2 is also, I'll do one thing. I'll copy all these things and that. I'll write again. Just observe. Okay. You see here, we have this e-commerce site. Now a developer came. This is just an abstract class, or this is just like an index page. Now I want to write the book for this, or I want to write the code for this. I should know what are the topics. See, if you say quantum physics is not a single chapter, single paragraph. Quantum physics has so many, literally so many topics inside it. So many things that we should know about quantum physics. Forget about quantum physics. Let us think about Java itself. When I say Java, do we have a single topic, or can we explain what is Java in one word or one single line, or are the contents of Java in single line? No, it is not possible, right? Okay, so what did it? What is the course that we are going to? Are we going to learn Selenium, or are we going to learn development? We are going to learn Selenium. But then do we need all the topics of Java to use for Selenium? No, it is not needed. So what are the topics do we need? That we are going to learn. So that is how I prepared the course content, right? In the same way, now I want an e-commerce site. Now, what are the contents I need for e-commerce site? I'm writing this. Now, once I have all these requirements, once I have mentioned all these methods that what I'm going to see, or what I'm going to look at this e-commerce site, I'm going to look at this functionality. If all these functionality is there, then that site or the requirements what I asked is done. But whose responsibility is to take care of all these requirements, or who is going to develop all these requirements? Developers, right? So developers, they should know what are the requirements. They will have the requirements in documents as well. But to make sure that they don't miss any requirement, they create abstract classes where all the methods that they have to implement will be present here. Now, when they start implementing it, they will create a class called Flipkart. But this has to implement all the unimplemented methods, or this is the index. Whatever is present inside the index, that content should be present inside the book. Right? So that is why, which index I'm following? I'm following this index. So I'm using e-commerce set. Okay. Now you see here, when I'm extending this e-commerce set, Java is automatically telling me that, okay, this index has these many methods, but you did not implement anything. You have to implement all those methods. So the developers are forced to implement all the methods of the abstract class so that we are not going to miss any of the logic or any of the requirements. Clear? Okay.
Yeah, maybe some real time.
This is.
I understood. This is real time.
Some real time example, right?
Yeah,
I cannot write login complete code here, so I am using CISO statement. That's all. But the example is real time example. Okay, let us search. Yes. Let us see if they have any other examples. Okay, let us see if I can find better example than that. So here they are having shape as abstract class, where for that shape they have color, area, and some method toString, and they are having some get color method, get color, but they do not have any implementation. But you see a circle and a rectangle, both of them has to have color, area, and shape, right? So they are having this concrete class and concrete class, that means normal class, which is not an abstract class, where they are having this radius and all this. So they are going to implement these methods inside this. Let me show you that. You see, abstract class shape. Here they are using shapes as example. I am using e-commerce site as an example class. Okay. See, they have created abstract area, because area for circle, the formula for circle area calculation is different. The formula for area of a square will be different, right? Pi r square is for circle, and a square or side square is the area for square, right? So that is why they have unimplemented this, because and we should mandatorily implement this. Okay, and then this is a constructor where we are assigning a color. This is not mandatory. If you want to assign constructor, you can assign. Or if you don't want, you can ignore. Okay, and then they have a variable called color, but this is default, right? If it is default, what is the rule? We cannot access it from outside the package. So that is what did they do? They created a public method, setters and getters. This we are going to learn in the next concept called encapsulation. So you can ignore this as well for now. Okay, you see this shape now has only one method or two methods. That is toString method and area method. Rest all you can ignore, right? These two methods are there, which are not implemented. Okay. Now there is a circle class which is extending the shape, because every shape that you create should have these methods. Okay. So that is why there is a circle class which is extending a shape. When you are extending a shape, circle constructor, if you want, you can have it. Otherwise, you can ignore it. But you see here, this is having at the rate of override area, at the rate of override toString. In the area, we are implementing the logic. That's all. In toString, we are implementing the logic.
Okay.
Same.
Got
rectangle.
It.
Rectangle is another shape which is extending shape, which is an abstract class, because this is the class where we have mandatory things for the shapes. You see, this is constructor. You can ignore this constructor. But you see, area, length into width, implementation of area is separate for this, and implementation of toString is separate for this. That's all. So when you create a circle, it is having red color, and then 2x2 is radius. And then when you create a rectangle, you are passing the color of that rectangle and length and width. So based on these parameters, it is converting all or calculating the areas and giving us the output. That's all.
Okay.
So we are making this mandatory to implement in all the child classes. That's all. That is abstraction. The same concept, but I took e-commerce site as an example. I have all the unimplemented methods here. They use only two things, but I used multiple things. Now, square, circle, rectangle and circle. Here we'll have Flipkart and Amazon. My next example was that. Now I think it's clear for you, right?
Yeah. So it's like a blueprint we are using for all.
Every class is called as a blueprint in object-oriented programming, because whenever we are creating an object, the instance of that class is created. So we cannot say this abstract class is blueprint. This is simple. This is a simple abstract class, or you can unofficially, or for our understanding, we can call it as index. But the name of this is abstraction, abstract class. Okay, blueprint means it should have the implementation. You know what is blueprint? No, now we have Xerox machines, but earlier we used to have some kind of machines. Yeah, these were the Xeroxes earlier. These kind of Xeroxes. How are we getting this keys? There will be a paper or cloth, and then there will be blue color placed inside a box, and then we'll have our design inside that box. Now, once we press that box, the same design will be printed on the new copy. This is nothing but a Xerox.
Carbon copy.
Exactly, carbon copy. Older version of Xerox. Okay, so this is blueprint. So if you need to have a blueprint, you need to have this implementation on the original copy, right? If this design is already there on the original copy, then you can get it on the blueprint. So that is why you cannot call this abstract as blueprint. You have to call this class as a blueprint, because you have the implementation here. Whenever you create an object for this class, you will get all these implementations. But you cannot create an object for abstract classes. It is not possible to create objects for abstract classes or inherited interfaces. Okay, so you cannot call this as blueprint. It is just an abstract class where no implementation is present for now. For now, there is no implementation of these methods. I'm saying for now because there is some more extension. Since you we got to another topic, so I'm just continuing that, and then let's go back. Okay, so for now there are no implemented methods. These are all abstract methods. Okay, is that clear?
Yeah.
Right. So now Flipkart is an e-commerce site where we are for all e-commerce sites, we need all these things minimum, right? So we need all these things. So we implemented for we are going to implement all these methods on Flipkart. But since we have another example that need to be seen, that what if all the methods we cannot implement all the complete logic in a single class, right? It is not possible. See, even when we are learning Java, we did not learn all the topics in a single class. We created around 20 classes, 21 classes. And then for object-oriented programming, we did not do it in single class. We did it in 6 different classes to understand topics. So in similar way, while we are developing this Flipkart application, we may not implement all these methods in a single page or single class. We may have to divide it into multiple classes based on the functionality, based on the complexity, or based on the requirement. Right? So here, I have implemented all the methods in a single class, but I don't want to implement all the methods in a single class. I cannot, because a single developer or a single page cannot be accessed by all the developers at the same time and develop all those things. So that is why I am, as my responsibility or as my work, these 3 implementations are assigned to me, so I am going to work. And what about the others? I am not going to work on them. So it is mandatory to make my class also abstract, so that it will not throw any error. Otherwise, I will not be able to compile, or I will not be able to test my code in the local. Understood? That is, if I have unimplemented methods of the abstract class. There are 7 methods, but I implemented only 3. Then what about the other 4? I'm not going to implement in this. I'm going to implement in another class, or another developer who is working on it, like Bobby or Yanji or Sharap is working on the other methods. So I don't, I cannot write dummy methods inside this, right? So that is why I am making my classes abstract, so that the other developer who is working on it will extend my class so that they can implement all the remaining methods. Understood? In the shape example, they used only 1 class. They did not have any unimplemented methods. Whatever the methods they have, they implemented it inside the class itself directly. Okay. But I'm giving some extra example that what if I don't want to implement all the methods here, then I'll make the class as abstract and I'll create another class Flipkart 2, which is extending Flipkart. Now I do not extend e-commerce set because e-commerce set has 7 methods, out of which 3 methods are already implemented. Now I should implement remaining methods. I will not write these methods again. I don't want to write these methods again. I want to write the remaining methods after I complete this. So how will I know that? I have to extend this Flipkart. That's all. Now it will throw an error and it will ask me to add unimplemented methods. Those unimplemented methods are other than these methods. Login, login management, product sales. Other than that, what are they? Wish list, cart page, COD and cards. You see here, wish list, cart page, COD and cards. So we are forcing the developers to implement all the methods which are present in this. That is the usage of abstraction. See here, again, we are using inheritance concept only. And we are using polymorphism concept. Overriding is nothing but polymorphism, right? This is login method and this is also login method. But I am writing code for this here. This is overriding. And the next tense is the concept of inheritance. So once you know what is inheritance and what is overriding, then you will understand this abstraction. That is the reason I designed this course in that way. First, we'll learn about inheritance, then polymorphism, then abstraction. Okay. All right. Now let me copy all these implementations which I have. Right. So is that clear now? Now this is for Flipkart. Now there is another e-commerce site like Amazon class. Amazon. This is also of type e-commerce site. So I'm going to I should know what are all the mandatory methods. So I'm extending with e-commerce site. Now you see here, this will also ask all the unimplemented methods to add. If you see, these are all the unimplemented methods. Login, login via Gmail, product search, wish list, cart page, payment methods, cash and delivery, payment method, cards. So whenever you are implementing or whenever you are extending e-commerce site, that means whenever you are developing Amazon, Flipkart, Alibaba or Myntra, any other sites, you should have all these methods. You understood? Now if you compare the other example which we saw here, they are using shape and then they are using circle and rectangle. Here we are using e-commerce site. For this e-commerce site, we are using Flipkart and Amazon. That's all. So if you want to, you have some mandatory methods or you have some mandatory implementation that needs to be done without missing, then you create them as abstract class. And then ask the developers to use them for all the places where they want to develop an e-commerce. Like, for example, whenever you know the ISI standards or W3C standards, or there are some guidelines for each and everything, right? Or if it is in India, there are some guidelines led by RBI for all the banks to follow. Or the income tax department for all the tax holders. There are some guidelines. If you have some this amount, you have to pay this tax. Or if somebody is coming for you, coming to you for a loan, then you should give only this percentage of amount of loan. You should not charge more or you should not charge less. There will be some repo rate and all these calculations. Right. Even in any place, you'll have these guidelines. So those guidelines are implemented by authorities and those all the organizations who are regulated by those authorities should follow those guidelines. In a similar way, this is my authority or this is my site where it is giving all the instructions. And every class of type e-commerce site or any class which is extending e-commerce site should implement all these methods. These are the guidelines for all the e-commerce sites. Kind of thing. Understood? right? Since Flipkart is implemented in multiple classes, so I am taking the latest child class object Flipkart 2, so that I can access all the methods site object cart login via Gmail. Then site object dot what do we have else? Product search, right? And then site object dot wish list. Did I implement this login via Gmail and product search in Flipkart? Where are they? They are in Flipkart. But this Flipkart 2 is extending Flipkart. I will be able to access these things.
But we cannot create object from e-commerce site, right?
We cannot create. That is why we are not creating object for e-commerce site. We are creating object for Flipkart 2, but we are converting that Flipkart 2 to e-commerce site. This is not overriding, but we use this concept for overriding. See, what am I doing? See, whenever you want to create an object, you have to call a constructor of that class. So I am calling the constructor of Flipkart. So this is creating an object for me, right? This is creating an object for me for Flipkart 2. Okay, let me go back. Where are the data types? See here, whenever I want to store a value, this is my value, but I am telling Java this value is of type what? 127 is of type byte. So I mentioned byte and I gave a variable name, right? Agree? Oh, you can see here, I am having a character here. I am assigning it in this variable and I am telling Java that what type of variable is this character?
Yeah.
Right? Now let's come here. Understanding the same thing. Now I'm creating a type of object. What? What type of object? Or for what class? Flipkart 2. But I'm telling Java I'm telling my compiler that this Flipkart 2 is of type e-commerce site. I can do this because Flipkart 2 is a child of e-commerce site. See your family name. Flipkart 2's family name is e-commerce site.
Yeah, no, obviously the Flipkart is a child of e-commerce site, so we can do this. But when it is compared with abstract class, it's kind of confusing. I don't know. You said you cannot create object for this.
Yeah, now we are not creating object for e-commerce site. We are creating object for a Flipkart.
We are creating for the child.
We are creating object for the child class, but we are telling that this is of type e-commerce site.
Yeah, and this is actually the overriding, right?
Exactly.
What is the difference between overriding and this one then?
Abstraction and overriding is completely different. In overriding, you do not have unimplemented methods. You do not use
abstract. No, I'm not asking abstract. That above one is
only this one. Yeah. We use the same line. For overriding, for abstraction. Because here, what are we doing? We are overriding the methods, right?
Okay.
We use the same line. This is overriding only. I mean, this line is not overriding. This is concept of overriding. Having the same method in the parent class and child class and having the implementation or changing the implementation in the child class is called as overriding. That we have already learned. This is overriding. But writing this line does not become overriding.
If you don't mind, can you go to that overriding chapter?
Sure,
Here. In the, what do you say?
You see, writing this line is not overriding. Overriding is having this implementation changed is overriding. Now I have this CIFA method overriding where I have print names, where we are having our names, okay? And in the sample class also, I have another method, print names, which is having course names. Okay. Now, I want to change the method or I want to change the implementation of these print names. So what I'm doing, I am extending this sample class and I'm writing the method with a different code. That is nothing but overriding. Okay. But to see its working, we are creating like this. We are creating an object for child class and converting it to parent type. Then only the overriding will be happening.
Okay. Some implementation has to be there. Okay.
Some implementation has to be there. See, actually this is overriding. We have the same method in parent class. We have the same method in child class. You are overriding it. You already overwritten it. But now you want to see this method, right? When you are running it. If you want to see while executing, then you have to create an object in this way. When I created object for sample class, it was printing this one only. When I'm creating object for method overloading and method overriding and storing in method overriding type, it was printing this only. But I don't want to see separately. I want to override this method. And always I want only this. So that is why what I'm doing, I'm converting the child class object to parent class object. So every time I run this code, while compiling, it will show that I am getting the print names from this. But while I am running, it will print these names. That's what we did in overriding, right, in our previous session.
Okay.
Do you want me to run and show?
No. Now I got it. So when we have the same like print names, it's overriding because it has something implementation. Exactly.
Same concept is here. Now you have the login method, whether it has implementation or not. It doesn't have any implementation, but the method name is login, right?
Yeah.
Now again, I'm having the login method here. That means what? I'm overriding this method.
Yeah, but just now you said it's not overriding.
No, when I'm having these methods and I'm implementing those methods, this is overriding. I said, if you say that this is overriding, this is
No. I didn't mean that.
Okay.
I'm saying only. When you said public void login, and here also public void login, it's nothing but this overriding. I'm saying.
Yeah. This is overriding. But when you
said
creating of this object and converting to e-commerce site is overriding, that is not.
No. What I mean is both are having login. So we have to assign a variable like this, like overriding. That's what I said. Okay, got it.
It is not mandatory. I'll show you one. Okay, your understanding is partially correct. I'll show you one more thing so that you will understand it clear. See here, Flipkart 2 is not an abstract class. So I can create an object for Flipkart 2, right? I'm creating an object for Flipkart 2. Equals to new Flipkart 2. Okay, I can create an object for this class. Okay, but when I try to access Flipkart 2 object, what are the methods are present in this Flipkart 2? Since this is extending parent, it is also giving all these methods. But when you create an object for this class, you won't get all the methods implemented in this. Okay, you won't be able to see all the methods since we are extending it. When we create an object for Flipkart 2, we are able to see all the methods. See, from Flipkart class and from Flipkart 2 class. Okay, but what am I doing? I am not using this Flipkart 2 to Flipkart. I am converting this Flipkart 2 to e-commerce site so that I will be able to access all the methods of this e-commerce site, not the Flipkart 2 class. I am able to access all the methods of this e-commerce site. Since I have to access all the methods of this e-commerce site, I am converting my Flipkart 2 object to e-commerce site object. Understood? You will still be able to create object for Flipkart 2.
Yeah, then for Flipkart 2, I don't need to write these things, right? Public void login, public void products. It automatically will inherit, correct?
Exactly.
So, okay. Can you write the method for that, for Flipkart 2? You have it already? No. Go back to that Flipkart 2.
Okay, Flipkart 2.
All the way down. Yeah, here. Still. But it automatically inherit, right? Then why do we need to write here public void wish list, cart page, PIM?
There are no methods implemented right here. See, okay. where is the wish list method? We have declared it in the e-commerce site, but we do not have any implementation. Just a second. Follow up with the dates already.
Okay.
Yeah. So we have declared all the methods, but we don't have the implementation. I have implemented only three methods, and I asked the Yanji's help to implement the other methods. So Yanji is implementing those methods in the other class.
Okay.
Okay. Is that clear, Bobby?
Yeah, kind of. Today class is a little bit confused. Okay.
Here it is a mixture of inheritance, polymorphism, and then abstraction.
Okay.
Okay. So this, when we are using extents, this is having the concept of inheritance.
That inheritance.
Means Flipkart 2 is getting all the properties of Flipkart.
Yeah, that is very clear, the inheritance property.
And then because overriding,
the child, it's inheriting.
Child, it is inheriting. See, actually, I'm going in a reverse now, just to make you understand. Then I'll come from forward again, okay? So this is inheritance, which is getting all the properties of our Flipkart class.
Correct.
Okay? And then this is overriding because we already have a method of wish list. So we are overriding wish list. But is this wish list present in this Flipkart class?
Yeah.
Where is it? It is not there in this wish list, right? We have only three: login, login via Gmail, and product search. But do we have wish list in this Flipkart?
But it extended to that child to child class, right? Subclass kind of.
This Flipkart is again extending e-commerce site.
Yeah, subclass. Yeah.
Okay, fine. Even if it is extending e-commerce site, and then you are using this, actually this wish list will not come here. When it will come here? When you make this Flipkart as abstract. When you make these classes abstract. Why did I make these classes abstract? Because there are some unimplemented methods in my class. I implemented only three methods. There are four other methods that I have to implement. I did not implement them, so I made my Flipkart classes abstract. That is mandatory. Understood? Okay, let's go down. You see Amazon, which is also extending e-commerce set. You see here, there are seven methods, all the methods. If I am implementing all the methods, I don't have to mention this as abstract. But if you have some methods which are unimplemented, let me, I'll remove this one of the method. You see this, it will throw an error. What is it saying? See, it's throwing an error, right? Because there is one method missing. The suggestions, you see.
So you have to take that to the another subclass.
Exactly. You see here, e-commerce site dot payment method cards is missing. Okay. Either we have to implement that, or you have to make this Amazon as abstract.
Okay. So if I take anything from the abstract class, that means I have to use all those
methods. Yeah. If you don't if you are going to implement in child classes, other child classes, then you make this class as abstract. That is the concept that I try to explain here by creating two subclasses.
Okay.
E-commerce side, but I was unable to implement all the seven methods. I am taking help of Yanji, where she is writing the other four methods. But she should know what are the methods that she should implement. So I made my class as abstract.
Got it.
Got it, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So now, to see that overridden methods while running, if you want to see that overridden methods, then what are we doing? We are converting our Flipkart 2 object to e-commerce site object and then calling all the methods which are present inside the e-commerce. That is what we did in overriding, right? When you override, it will show all the methods of the sample class. Print names and say hello. You see? All the methods of sample class, which is overridden class. As well as you will also able to see this side. See? Yeah, that's all. But it is not getting the child class because anyway we are converting this child to parent, right? So you will not be able to access the child class methods. But it will be able to access all the parent class members. So parent class methods have print names and say hello. But what did we override? Only print names. You see, only print names is overridden. So in the same way, whatever the methods we have written, we are overriding those things. This method, this class, we have something, and this class, we have something. If we create object only for this class, we will be able to access only this class, as well as, since we are extending this flipkart, we will be able to access this. But if you want to access all the methods of, okay, let me do one thing. Let me do. I cannot show you that because for abstraction, again, we have to, if I create another subclass, then I have to use the same extents. Okay. So like this, we will, it will become, we have a list of methods and we will be able to access all the list of methods. And we made sure the developers implemented all these methods. If they are not implementing, it will throw an error and the project will not run. Okay. So this is abstraction, basic abstraction. We have abstracted, we have some methods, abstract methods. We implemented in a single class, that is this. Amazon has all the methods implemented in a single class. This is one way. You can implement all the unimplemented methods in a single class. Or if you don't wish to implement in a single class, then you should make the classes abstract. And then you have to implement all the remaining methods in the other class. Until you, why should we make this as abstract? Because if you are not, if Java is not allowing, if Java is not seeing any error, or if Java is not asking us to implement the other methods, what will happen? We will implement these three methods and we will forget. Then who is going to take care of these four methods? Somebody has to take care of, right? If I do not create abstract, if I do not ask Java, or if Java does not ask me to make this as abstract, I can create an object for this flipkart class and I can use these three methods. But Java should not allow me, right? Because there are some unimplemented methods. So that is why it is forcing us to make this unimplemented or partially implemented class as abstract class. This is the logic behind it. Am I clear?
Yeah.
Okay. Now this is abstraction. But now let us see some more examples of this same. Okay. It is not mandatory for an abstract class to have all abstract methods. Even an abstract class can have implementations. Void get order ID. See, so order ID is something like this. An abstract class can have implemented methods as well. This is also one of the points that you should remember. If you don't think that if I mark this class as an abstract, then all the methods should be abstract. An abstract class can also have implemented methods. That is why when I'm giving the definition or when I'm explaining this, I told if a class has a single abstract method, class has at least one abstract method, then that class must be abstract. Understood?
Okay, at least one should have abstract. Remaining exactly. Can be a implementation. Okay.
Exactly. At least if there is at least one abstract method, then that class must become abstract. Understood? Clear, right?
Fine. Yeah.
Abstract methods, normal methods, abstract methods doesn't have implementation, normal methods have implementation within the blocks. Based on the methods, classes are divided into abstract classes and normal classes. If the method is abstract, the class will become abstract. If there are no abstract methods, then it is not needed for us to make the classes abstract. It will become normal. And the points to remember is, abstract class is a class which contains at least a single abstract method in it. If it contains at least a single abstract class, then that is, if it contains a single abstract method inside it, then the class must be abstract. So you should explain in this way. You should not say this. Because you can create abstract classes without any abstract methods. You see, I'm removing this. Then, doesn't this become an abstract class? Still it's an abstract class, right?
No, at least one of them should have abstract, right?
No, it is not throwing any error. Even if there are no abstract methods, abstract list can have implementations as well. So I am mentioning, I am marking this class as abstract, but it is of no use. Though it is marked as abstract, there are no abstract methods. I am not going to implement anything out of this. Right. The purpose of abstracts is what? You have the mandatory guidelines or mandatory requirements, and then whoever is going to work on this e-commerce site, they have to implement all those requirements. But I do not have any requirements here, and I am marking this as abstract. Does it serve our purpose? No. An abstract class can be 100% implemented. It is not mandatory to have, a class can be marked as abstract, but all the methods inside it can be implemented. But that does not serve our purpose. You can have this. Java allows you to mark this as abstract, though there are no abstract methods inside it. Okay. Java allows us, but we do not have any use with this. So when we want to say the definition of abstract class, then we should say that if any method inside a class is abstract, then that class must be abstract. You can mark this as abstract, but it cannot have any, it can or cannot have abstract methods. But if it has a single abstract method, let me show you. These have abstract methods, but if I remove this abstract, it will throw an error. Now you see, that means this class is depending on these methods, right? Since there are abstract methods, it is asking me to keep this as abstract. But if I remove this, see, it is not throwing any error. So the purpose of abstract, or any class will become abstract class if there is any abstract method inside it, or if there is a single abstract method inside a class, then that class must be abstract. Understood? Slight difference. You can write an abstract class and you can have all the methods implemented, but that doesn't serve the purpose of abstraction. Abstraction means what? Unimplemented methods. If there are no unimplemented methods in that class, but you are saying that this is an abstract class, then what is that? Useless, right? So that is the reason we don't say that definition. We say this. If any abstract method is present inside a class, then that class must be abstract class. I know it looks like a tongue twister, but it's logically a little different. That's all. Since the class is abstract, it is not mandatory to have an abstract method. But if we have an abstract method, it is mandatory to mark this class as abstract. Just a second. So sorry. Some emergency error. Okay, so yeah, a class should be abstract if it has a single abstract method. But it is not mandatory to have abstract method inside an abstract class. You can have all the methods implemented in an abstract class. Okay, abstract class gives us the flexibility that either the method can be abstract or the method can be implemented. It is not a rule that abstract class should have all the abstract methods. Okay? The next, to represent a class or methods, abstract keyword is used. This we have seen. And it is not possible to create object for abstract classes. This also we have seen. And then implementation of abstract methods should be done in child classes. This is nothing but overriding. That is what we have seen. And we have to complete the implementation of all methods either by using a single class or by creating multiple child classes. That is what we did. For e-commerce site, for Flipkart, I did it in multiple child classes. For Amazon, I did it in single class. Okay. If multiple child classes are used, we need to declare all the incomplete child classes as abstract classes, though there are no abstract methods. That is what we did for Flipkart. What? Do I have any abstract methods inside this? No. But since I am having unimplemented methods inside this, so I made this class as abstract class. That is the rule of abstraction. If you have unimplemented methods in the class, then you have to make that class as abstract class. You see now, this class is called as abstract class. But do we have any abstract methods inside this? No, right? Yeah. Because the abstract methods which are inside the parent are unimplemented here. So the rule of Java is to make this unimplemented or partially implemented class. Abstract classes may or may not contain abstract methods. This also we have seen. This is an abstract class. It may or may not contain abstract methods. We do not have any abstract method here. And here also we see abstract class. We have implementation method. We can have this. Okay. That is all about abstraction. There is another topic called interface. So this is a task for you. I have the notes. I have to share these notes, but you find the difference between interface and abstraction so that you can explore what is abstraction, a little more on abstraction, and you can also find the differences of abstraction and interface. The major difference between abstraction and interface earlier was, see now, abstract classes are allowing these methods and implementations of the methods inside the abstract class. But interfaces were not allowing these implementations inside this interface. Interfaces are 100% abstract earlier. But now later, after some versions of Java, they have changed that rule. Now you have to find the differences between abstraction and interface. After Java 13 or 14, both abstraction and interface became almost the same with a little differences. Okay, you find the differences and tell me what is the difference between abstraction and interface by tomorrow. Okay, all right. We have 10 more minutes remaining. You have any questions in today's topic, abstraction?
Or any questions in previous topics?
No questions? Okay, if no questions, then I'll explain a little more about the interfaces in the same session. Okay, let's continue with the interfaces.
Okay.
If you have questions, please let me know. I'll stop this. We can see interfaces tomorrow, or you find the difference and we can discuss. No questions, right?
No.
Yes. See here, same as abstraction, we have a keyword called interface. Okay. Interface, I do not use the keyword called class here. I'm not going to mention the class. I'm going to say interface shape. We have seen that abstraction example shape, right? So the same shape. Now, interface. All the methods by default are abstract. Abstract. What are the methods that we have seen? Abstract area.
We can have only abstract method. That's all the thing.
Yeah. Only abstract methods. Now we see here, if I try to write non-abstract methods. For example, public void get shape name. Is it allowing me to write?
It doesn't support. It doesn't support.
What is it saying? Abstract methods do not specify a void. By default, the methods inside an interface, even though you do not mention the abstract keyword, by default, the methods inside this interface are abstract in nature. See? Did I mention abstract here? No, but by default, even if you don't mention the abstract keyword, this is an abstract method. by default. Like even if you do not have a constructor, Java will create a by default, it will assume that there is an empty constructor. In the same way, by default, when you use the keyword called interface, by default, the methods inside this interface are abstract. Understood? That's all. That is the major difference between abstraction and interface. Rest all concepts is same. Now suppose I have I have a class where I want to implement all these abstract methods. Okay, class circle. Okay, class circle. This is interface, right? So we cannot use extend schema. Extends is for class to class. This is an interface, so we have to use implements. Implements. What is that? Shape. This circle is implementing shape. Now it will ask me to implement all the unimplemented methods. Area and get shape. That's all. Now if you don't want to implement this, then this class will become abstract because it has unimplemented method. Now you have to create another class circle2, for example, another class circle2. Now we should not use the implements keyword because this is a class and this is a class. So what are we going to do? Extends. Now this will implement get shape. That's all. So interface to class implements, class to class extends. How extends is creating? See, circle 2 will become child of circle with the help of extends. Similarly, circle will become child of shape with the help of implements. Understood? That's all. Nothing else. Let's see the notes.
Interface supports multiple inheritance, whereas abstract class doesn't support multiple inheritance.
Okay. Yeah, that is also one of the difference that I'm going to show you now. Partial abstraction is allowed in interfaces in latest Java versions, but I don't like it for what Java version I'm using. Okay. And there is that. Yeah. By default, all interfaces are public and abstract. Cannot create private or protected interfaces. We cannot mark this interface as private. It will throw an error. Illegal modifier for the interface shape. Only public and abstract are. See? So it is not allowed to have this private or all those things. Class implementing the interface method should implement all the methods. Otherwise, they should be declared as abstract. That's what we saw. The class which is implementing the shape, it should implement all the methods. If not, then you mark the class as abstract. Okay, that is what we did. And then interface to interface, we use the keyword called extends. And interface to class, we use implements. Okay. Partial abstraction is allowed in interfaces. But in latest Java versions, but which Java version I'm using? It is Java version 15, but still it is not allowing me. Might be there are some things that I need to change. That is why it is not allowing. I saw that the partial implementation will be possible in interface. So nowadays, both interface and abstract both became same. Oh, sorry, this is partial implementation. I did already partial implementation earlier, old versions of Java 8 and 7. This was not allowed. If you are implementing any interface, all the methods should be implemented in the same class. That was the concept earlier. But now, partially implemented, right? I implemented partially. And then the other methods are implemented in other classes. This is partial implementation of interface. Okay. Right. A class can implement any number of interfaces. This is what you said, multiple inheritance. A class can implement any number of interfaces. Now you see here we have implements shape. I can also implement another. Suppose I have interface. Yes. Filling. Something. Okay, I have interface filling. Why? Something. So here I can implement both by using a comma. But for abstract classes, that is not possible. For implementation, for interfaces, you can have multiple inheritance. But for abstract classes, multiple inheritance is not possible. Understood? You see, it is throwing an error. Add unimplemented methods, gradient and solid. From where are these coming? From filling. So that is all about interfaces aspect. So we are done with abstraction and interfaces. Now there are some small differences, other small differences. Almost all the differences are here. You also try to find the differences and try to understand the differences between abstraction. If you find something interesting, please. All right. Any questions on interface?
Interface is same like abstraction.
Same abstraction, but it is 100% abstraction. 100% abstract. We cannot have implementations inside an interface. Okay. Bye bye guys. Have a great day.
Yeah, thank you. You too. Bye.